John. This will be our 60th in exposition of this book. We're going to be in verses 15 through 18. I wanted to set the stage a little for this. When John began his gospel, he began by proclaiming who Jesus was before he came to earth. He said he was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He continued to elaborate. He said, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. When he shined his light, John said the darkness comprehended it not. They couldn't tell whether the light was shining or not. But he was the true light that gives light to every man. Anyone that's enlightened or illuminated, Christ did it. To those who received him, John said, he gave power to become the sons of God. That's a pretty big leap now we've gone. In the first chapter, that's a pretty big leap. To as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Now, if I remember right, Abraham wasn't called a son of God. It's like a new term. Then he said the Word that was in the beginning with God and was God, the Word became flesh. That's a pretty big condescension. And dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. But the fullness of it, not everybody saw this glory. But they were looking. When they looked at Jesus, they were looking at the glory of God. That's what they were looking at. Now, these truths that I've just mentioned are lived out in Christ's earthly ministry. Those declarations, together with a number of other declarations that are in the Scripture, were fleshed out in the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ. When he went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, they were proving that in the beginning the Word was with God and was God. See, they substantiated that he didn't come from here. What he did confirmed he was not from the earth. He came from someplace else. And the opposition of Satan and his hosts was how Satan reacts to God, and how he reacts to light, and how he reacts to Christ. And his dealing with the world confirms that Satan's trying to make everybody like himself. That's his target. Now, when Jesus was here among men, he had absolute power and authority. He never one time confronted a situation he didn't control.
Amen.
Never. The only exception appeared to be his death, but he controlled that.
That's right.
They couldn't touch him till his time came.
That's right.
See, now John told you who he was in the beginning. If the Word was with God and was God, I mean, nobody controls God.
Yeah.
Nobody engages in a war with God and makes any kind of progress. So the Word, this is lived out. It had to be fleshed out before men. It wasn't enough for them just to hear about it. They had to see. They had to see with their eyes. And here was somebody they could not control.
Yes, amen.
And here was somebody Satan could not dominate.
That's right.
And whenever he confronted something he dealt with, there was never any failure on his part. Now, the fact that God Almighty supported Jesus confirms that God sent him and God was for Jesus because he supported him in whatever he did. Also, Jesus confirmed in his earthly ministry, he didn't come to only save the Jews. He confirms in his earthly ministry, he dealt with some Gentiles enough so you'd know his ministry wasn't limited to the Jews. And you learn in Christ's earthly ministry how intolerant he was of a religion of routine. Well, you wanted to see Jesus, as they say, get ticked off. You put before him lifeless routine,
that's right,
and he will not be quiet about it.
Amen.
See, this is demonstrated to us what God thinks of these things. God could declare this in the scriptures, and the Psalms have a number of expressions about how God feels about iniquity.
Uh-huh.
But when Jesus came, you saw it.
Amen.
It was lived out. The power of the Savior to forgive sins is made known. He said to at least two people we know, he said, your sins are forgiven.
Yeah.
See, God is a God that forgives sin. It's one thing to hear that. It's another thing to see it happen.
Yes, amen.
Right before a person. In fact, I believe you'll find it difficult, if not impossible, to find a view of God that was not lived out by Christ.
Amen. Yeah. Right.
It's something to think about.
You know, this thing about him being able to forgive sins, in our contemporary age, it's hard for them to tie that together with the justice and the righteousness and the wrath of God.
Yeah.
When he healed this man, he told him, you don't sin anymore, or a worse thing will come. See, they can't put those two together.
I know it.
That they say, well, see, he just loves us so much, and when he does. But see, when he forgave his sins, he gave him this proviso. You now you're set free. Don't go back into sin. This is quite a thing.
It sure is. As I said, I don't think you will find any trait of God that was not lived out in the ministry of Christ, from his omniscience to his omnipotence. And the apex of the revelation is the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ.
Yes.
It reached its crescendo.
Yeah, amen. Yeah.
In those, the death of Christ, this was like a curse before men. But here it's made it turn into a blessing. Death is turned into a blessing. Who but God could do this?
Amen.
And here was a person death couldn't hold. The last enemy couldn't hold him. It held everybody else, but it couldn't hold him.
Amen.
And earth couldn't keep him here. He ascended right straight up from the earth to glory. All these things, again, lived out in the ministry of Christ. And I'm going to endeavor to substantiate that tonight. Now, our text is John 5, 15 through 18. We're still dealing with this man that was at the pool of Bethesda, an impotent man whom Jesus had healed. The man departed. It's the man he healed. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him because he'd done these things on the Sabbath day. But Jesus answered them, my Father worketh hitherto, or before this, and I work. I know that didn't make a lot of sense to his critics, but we want to make some good sense out of it here tonight. The man he healed, says the man departed. Well, that's the first time probably in his life he ever walked away from the pool of Bethesda. We gather that he was doing what Jesus told him to do. Jesus said, rise, take up your bed, and walk. All right, so this is what he was doing.
Mm-hmm.
First time in 38 years and probably in his entire life when he had walked, to say nothing of carrying his bed while he did. First time things. The scripture never tells you how these people felt the first time. Now, you have to know the Bible to know this. But no one ever said, "Whoa, boy, this is really something." You never read anything like that. It's just interesting. I'm not sure what conclusion to draw from that, but you don't have that kind of reaction to what Jesus did. People glorify God because they saw it. They praise God before they saw it. We have seen strange things today, but no one told you how they, quote, felt. That's the woman you're told felt in herself. She was healed, but she didn't say that. That's what the Spirit told us. Now this, Jesus never healed anyone. And there were lingering effects of the condition he healed. Now the two possible exceptions would be the blind man that he touched twice outside Bethsaida. And the nobleman's son who began to amend. But in both those cases, both of them ended up thoroughly healed. See, so that's what I'm going to make here. And when the healing was complete, there was any lingering effects. Like he never healed a crippled man that had to have a cane. Or a blind man that needed glasses. You might be surprised how many people talk about being healed and they got lingering effects.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, we just need to call it something else. Mm-hmm. See, we begin to amend. That'd be a good language to adopt. Began to amend. So Jesus didn't come to make people just like better.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are some people, they'd be satisfied if Jesus just made them better. But Jesus didn't come to just make people better.
Amen.
That wasn't his purpose. Without healing them thoroughly, see.
Yeah.
Now, this is teaching us that when it comes to sin, physical healing is a mirror of the forgiveness of sins.
Amen.
It tells you what happens. Jesus doesn't forgive a man's sin and regenerate him, and the lingering effects of enslavement to sin remain.
Amen. That's right.
This isn't so. I know you may have effects like scars. I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus, as Paul said. But I'm talking about sin maintaining a grasp.
Yes.
There's all kind of people right in this town we're living in. There's all kind of people that are in the grip of sin.
Yes.
That have been told they've been forgiven. Mm-hmm. They're still in the grip.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying that this ministry of Jesus, at the very least, suggests that's not how Jesus works.
Yeah.
He's not a Jesus of partial things.
Right.
Not this Christ. A person who's born again will experience inner peace. Let's say, for instance, our prayer requests should be shaped by the optimum of what Jesus does. Not the minimum of what he does. Now, if you're not careful, and I include myself with this, if you're not careful, you'll pray as though you'll settle for a minimal healing or whatever from God. But it seems to me like you should pray with the optimum in mind. And if it's not God's will, then you subject it to God's will. You make your request, and don't let your request be for minor. Let your request be for major. Then he'll give you peace. That's what the scripture says. Then he'll give you peace, so this won't agitate you anymore. Well, Paul, he wasn't healed. But he had peace. So much so he gloried in his infirmities. Because he says, I found out that when I'm weak, I'm strong. Well, I'm still in the process of learning that, but I want to be able to experience that much more.
Yes.
When I am weak, why? Why? When you're weak, you're strong. Why? Because then you have no alternative but faith. See, you have no alternative but to trust in Christ.
Yes. Uh-huh.
That's your only alternative. Mm-hmm. And that's strength. Because
yeah.
All things are possible to him that believes.
Amen.
And one thing that debility, disease, infirmity, handicap, it teaches you that you don't have everything you need. You've got to have some help. You need some grace. Mm-hmm. All these accounts of Jesus are teaching you he's quite willing to give grace.
Yeah.
He can completely eliminate the problem, mm-hmm. or he can make you able to go walk right through it just as though nobody from the outside even knows you got a problem.
That's right. Amen.
As Jesus. So we must be able to reason from the lesser, the healings Jesus proclaimed, accomplished. We must be able to reason from the lesser to the greater. When we're addressing sin, moral recovery, this type of thing, you got to reason on the basis of these miracles Jesus performed. They give you kind of like a skeleton outline of what Jesus does. Nothing's impossible with him. The person can be at a point where no one will even know they had a problem. Some of those lepers, unless the people had seen those lepers, I don't know that they'd have believed them when they told me, you know, I used to be a leper from head to toe. That's what I used to be. But if you hadn't seen the person before, you'd think he was exaggerating.
Uh-huh.
It's the same with some of us here. If I told you some of the things I've done in my past life, you would find it very difficult to believe.
Uh-huh. Yep.
That's how thoroughly I've been healed from those things. You have too. You've all got things like this.
Amen.
So in our text, the former impotent man left the pool under his own power. Yeah, how about that?
Yeah.
Now, it doesn't say what other people around there thought, but I've wondered about that. What others laying there thought when they saw him get up and pick up his bed and go away. They've been seeing him there every day, and all of a sudden he just leans down, picks up his bed, and walks.
Yeah.
See, the important thing isn't really what people think about you.
Yeah. Amen.
The important thing is what God thinks about you,
yes.
and it's to obtain the blessing. And if whether anybody else says anything about it or not, really doesn't make any difference, not to the person who was impotent and now can walk. In fact, God will work it this way. So he will deliver you from things you can't prove. That you were delivered from them. That's the genius of God.
Yes.
You know, you say, but you can't be lulled asleep by others that can't see it.
Uh-huh.
You know what's happened to you.
Amen.
Now it says he told the Jews had asked him, who is this that said, pick up your bed and walk? First they ask him, what are you walking with your bed for? He said, well, the one that healed me told me to pick up my bed and walk. He said, who is this that told you to pick up your bed and walk? Now, the first time they ask him, the scripture says he didn't know who it was. Because Jesus had conveyed himself away because there was a multitude there. Now, I don't know what fans of megachurch do with that text, but a multitude tends to repel Jesus. You just have to read, you have to be familiar with Scripture to see it, but this is the truth. If he had a multitude of listeners, then, of course, that's another matter. But that's not always what he had. But now he tells, now, something's happened since that first time. He didn't know who it was. He wist not who it was. That's what it said when they first asked him. But now he tells him it's Jesus. Well, how did he know? Well, Jesus, remember, Jesus found this man in the temple. And it does. All the dialogue said was, go your way and don't sin lest the worst thing come to you. But Jesus must have revealed to him who he was. So that's how this man, knew. And he told him it was the one that told me to pick up my bed and walk. So you might think that would have caused, well, that, but that, he must be some man, to do something like that.
Yeah.
So as a result, these people persecuted Jesus. that was their reaction to Jesus healing this man.
Yeah.
Why? Because the way Jesus went about it contradicted their ideas.
That's right.
Of the Sabbath day and so
yes,
forth.
Amen.
See? Now, you'd be surprised how many people will disagree with you, not because what you say is unreasonable, but because it clashes with the way of how they see things. So they may even oppose you. Not because there's a flaw in your reasoning, or not because what you're saying is bad, but what's bad about saying, I was healed, and a man healed me, told me to pick up a bed and walk. But this grated against them because it was contrary to their religious traditions. It's still this way. This is still this way. Some of you perhaps have endured this. You've endured opposition, and the only reason you did is because what you embraced didn't coincide with what they thought. So maybe they thought you were a heretic or something like this. They just didn't understand. This is what kind of a grip religious tradition can get on a person. We're seeing this lived out, see. Religious tradition is extremely potent.
Yeah. Amen.
It has enslaved millions and probably billions of people over the years. Just sheer tradition with no real basis at all. It's just the wisdom of men personified. So they persecuted Jesus on this technicality. As a matter of fact, and when it says persecuted, it doesn't mean they rendered physical harm to him. Nobody touched Jesus. You must know this. Nobody laid a hand on Jesus. The first time anybody anywhere put a hand on Jesus of enmity was when he was betrayed in the garden, and nobody did it until that day. Nobody touched him. Not one of his enemies put a hand on him. He was completely impervious to any kind of assault. The one that says they persecuted Jesus, it doesn't mean they threw stones at him and this sort of thing. They harassed. They tried to trick him with questions. They tried to snare his speech. That's the kind of persecution we're talking about. But that is persecution.
Amen.
And if you've ever endured that, you know that is persecution.
Yes.
Someone's always jabbing at you. They're not physically hurting you, but they're just all the time prodding you and making fun of you and laughing at you, questioning what you believe. See, that's persecution.
Yes.
That's what that is. It's just a kind of a milder form. But then sometimes that's not so mild either. That type of thing can get through to you. If you don't live close to God, this will beat you down.
Yeah.
Opposition will beat you down. If you don't live close to God and live by faith, you'll get discouraged when people close to you, sometimes your own family,
yes.
And they're against you and they've cast out your name as evil, and it'll beat you down. But you've got to stand tall. You can't be overcome by this kind of this kind of stuff. Well, they didn't end it there. They sought to kill Jesus. They sought to kill him. We're pretty early in his ministry now, right? This is pretty early in his ministry, and already they're plotting to kill him. In the latter part of Christ's ministry, he told his disciples that Jews would kill him. And several times, I give you some text. He told us over and over, repeated this to him, I'm going to be betrayed into the hands of the sinful man. They're going to crucify me and kill me, and the third day I'll rise from the dead. And over and over and over, he told them this. But they all missed it. None of the disciples picked up on this. The death of Christ completely caught them unawares. And the two on the road to Emmaus, they said, we thought this is the one. We thought, it's kind of amazing, isn't it? Now, you have to trace through these scriptures where Jesus told them at length what was going to happen. We're going to go to Jerusalem. This is going to happen. Uh-huh. They didn't pick up on it. Yes.
That word you gave on persecution, it's important that we have a broad sense of that. Because though today it's often limited to just like physical assault, you yes. as you said, but persecution, like as far as we're concerned, a very popular means is an attempt to ruin someone's character.
That's right.
Or to destroy their popularity.
That's
which,
right.
like in our country, we're not like free from that. That you'll find like for righteous sake, that's a very common form of persecution, is to destroy your character in some way, or misrepresent you or slander you, which is what they did try to do by linking him to Beelzebub and things of this sort. They tried to portray him differently than who he really was. Mm-hmm. That's a form of persecution.
And I think you'll find that where there was a overt persecution, it was generally preceded by this other milder form. Mm-hmm. See, this tends to escalate, so people aren't satisfied just to say something.
Yeah.
And they get to the point they want to do something.
Yeah.
So it was with Jesus also.
Fiercer persecution comes as a result of that not having the effect that they
want. That's right. Amen.
If the person stays strong, then they're going to resort to more harsher means. So just the fact they even resort to that says a lot about the person.
Mm-hmm. And now you've got people saying, "Well, but we should never agitate people. I mean, all you got to do is just you should be kind." And well, how do you put that in the context of Jesus and the Pharisees? There is obviously we should. Seek to be to live peaceably with all men, but sometimes you just can't.
Yeah. Now, maybe we could say an additional word about this. When there's an aggressive stance against like false teaching, that it's the ones who perpetrate the doctrine, not the people who accept it.
Uh-huh.
That's the difference between the two. When we're talking about those who perpetrate or spread. Originate, teach the false doctrine. There's nowhere in Scripture where we are told to pray for such people. If there is, you'd have to find it. But for people that have been duped by it, see that? Now we're talking about something else there. Now we're talking about a call for patience because they've been duped. Other people have embraced the thing, and they may not even be people. If you get where I'm coming from there. Now, as I mentioned, the disciples didn't pick up on this, even though Jesus over and over told them, Son of Man's going to be betrayed. Son of Man's going to be betrayed into the hands of sinful men. They'll beat him, they'll scourge him, they'll crucify him. The third day arise again. Oh, you'd think, how in the world could they have missed that? But they did. They missed it. And when Jesus died, they thought they'd misunderstood him completely. It must not. We thought this is the one.
Yeah. Yes.
See? Mm-hmm. So if you ever wonder how obtuse flesh is, if you ever wonder, there's you an example. You can be in the presence of Jesus Christ himself. And if you're not living by faith, if all you have is natural resources, you'll be caught off, completely off guard if Jesus does something you didn't think he'd do. That's what happened here with them. Remember, and then after he rose from the dead, and after he appeared to the disciples, he's getting ready to ascend back up into glory. In Acts 1:6, and the disciples said, "Will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" It still missed the whole kit and caboodle.
Yeah.
They didn't catch on till the day of Pentecost was fully come. Then now we got another.
Yeah.
So Jesus told them, "Stay in Jerusalem now.
Yeah.
Stay put till you're endued with power from on high." And when the power from on high came, this whole thing cleared up to them.
Yes, amen.
Peter could preach with authority on that very subject of Christ's death that very day, and he hadn't had hours and hours and hours to think about what happened.
Mm-hmm.
When the Holy Spirit filled those people, they knew right off the bat they could put it together.
Amen.
Boy, it's a great thing.
Yes.
To your own measure, you'll be able to do this.
Yes.
This is in measure. I understand that. But the more of the Holy Spirit you have, you'll be able to put things together. Because in the kingdom of God, it's when things are put together that they obtain their power.
Amen.
That's when there's power. It's like a quiver full of arrows versus one arrow in your hand. You put it together, you can link. And that's what happened at Pentecost. Look all the things they linked together. The death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. They linked it back to the prophets. They could handle this marvelously. Even before, when they were waiting for the day of Pentecost, they knew that Judas had to be replaced. Jesus didn't say, don't forget to replace Judas. See, he didn't tell his disciples that. But they reasoned it out because they knew the scriptures. So you know the scriptures, you walk with Jesus, you can think things out. And, of course, they give you the reason why, the Spirit gives you the reason why they persecuted Jesus, because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. They said this in themselves. It doesn't say they spoke it out loud. They said it in themselves. Therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus, sought to slay him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. Now, I'm particularly interested in how Jesus answers his critics. We can really learn from this and pick up on this sort of thing. Now, the text begins by saying, but Jesus answered them. And his answer doesn't sound like it was even related to the question, right? Is that what it doesn't look like it's even related to the question. Yeah, I'm interested in this word, but. A lot of the versions leave it out completely. There is a word there that's translated but. Some versions read so. It's in that Bible. The New International Version says, in his defense, he said. The New Jerusalem Bible says his answer was. Tyndale says his reply to their accusation was, William says in then. And what the word translated, but, I don't want to go into long discourse about language here and etymology, but the word sets a statement in opposition to a previous statement. It's a literary term. Where an inaccurate statement was made, and but introduces the accurate statement. And there's a lot of this in Scripture. A lot of this. In other words, this word indicated that the thinking of the opponents was wrong. And so Jesus is going to state the real case, because it's knowing the truth that sets you free. See, a view of the truth will never make you free. You know, everybody sees this. A view of the truth will not liberate you. A view of the truth will make you free. Only if you know the truth. If you know the truth will make you free. So they had interpreted the Sabbath completely wrong. Now, throughout his ministry, Jesus would expose erroneous thinking. See, people talk wrong because they think wrong.
Yeah, that's right. See,
so he'd correct their thinking. There's something to be seen of our Lord here. He will not allow false thinking to go unchecked. Even if he knows the person's thinking it in himself, never expressed it. There's cases where he did expose it, answered it. Why? Because in the kingdom of God, wrong thinking is lethal. It'll kill you. It'll take your spiritual life if you think wrong.
Yeah.
You've got to be thinking right and about critical things we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
We're not talking about little incidental things of life. We're talking about things pertaining to Christ, salvation, grace of God, so forth. Your thinking has to be right.
Amen.
If it's wrong, some way Jesus will let you know.
Mm-hmm.
It may be one of your brethren, maybe a member of your family, maybe you, a text of scripture just explodes your whole thought. Mm-hmm. And he ministers to you that way. But Jesus will not let you go by thinking wrong.
Yeah.
He'll deal with it. And I thank and praise God for it. So Jesus answers them. Here's his answer. My Father worketh hitherto, or in the past up to now. Remember they said, you did this, you were working on the Sabbath day. Mm-hmm. He says, my Father's never quit working. Mm-hmm. That's what he's saying. Mm-hmm. My Father worked way back there, and he's still working today. He never did quit working. So your thinking can't be right. There's a work that can be done on the Sabbath day. My Father worketh hitherto. Here's what some of the versions read. My Father has been working until now. That's a New King James Bible. My Father is always at work to this very day. NIV. My Father is still working. New Revised Standard. My Father constantly does good. Living Bible. My Father works unceasingly. See the ideas? You say, what about where the scripture says God rested on the seventh day? All right. That is true. Let's deal with that. Now, first of all, the Sabbath was not made for man, and it wasn't made for Jesus. He says the Sabbath's not made for man. Man was not made for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man. So Jesus wasn't made for the Sabbath.
That's right.
That's fine. In Mark 2:27, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. So I can do what I want on the Sabbath because I'm the Lord of the Sabbath.
Amen.
Well, it's good to know. Now, the Sabbath that was made, the Sabbath was not made for God either, much less the Son. But let's deal with this text. It says in Genesis 2:1, and on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he hath made. Hebrews 4:10 says, God ceased from his own works. All right, what does that mean? He ceased his creative work. Even though scientists say there's new stars forming, they're full of hot air. On one hand, they tell us this is like X million miles away, and it takes several million years for the light to get here, but they're still seeing what's going on down there. I mean, this is an insult to our intelligence. He quit his creative, his natural creative work, ended on the seventh day. It was done. And he hasn't made anything new in creation since. Maybe men have discovered some new things, but God didn't make anything new. He ceased from his own labors. That's what it says when he rested. He rested from his creative work, but he didn't rest from his sustaining work.
Amen.
He didn't rest from his revealing work.
Yeah, the prohibition of work on the Sabbath was actually to keep men from being wrapped up in the in the things of earth, where they had a time that could be devoted to God himself without the distractions of daily living, to be relieved of it somewhat.
It was a provision
so what Christ is doing here is not a distraction or a departure from the ongoing spiritual activity of the Godhead.
Amen. This work that they are opposing is a work that has been determined by God.
Yeah.
See, my Father is working. He's talking about this, right, that incident. He was working on that incident right there. His Father was working. So this can't be, you can't be right in your definition of what work is, because God has never quit working. And he worked, as a matter of fact, on this Sabbath day, he worked this miracle through me on this man here. Now, The bottleneck of seeing God's works is that man's mind has been distorted by delusion. We know from Scripture, Psalm 66:5 says, "Come and see the works of God." So God wants his works to be seen.
Yeah.
And the creative works, they are marvelous to me. There's no question about it. "When I behold, you know, the heavens and the handiwork of your hand, what's man that thou art mindful of him?" See, it's marvelous in nature.
Yeah.
But God's never quit working. Now he's creating in the spiritual domain.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's creating new hearts. And he's creating new spirits.
Yeah.
And he's creating people anew, see? New workmanship. So my father worked. My father's never quit working. And I'm working all the time, too.
Yeah.
Wherever I go, I'm at work.
Yeah.
I'm doing. See, the father doesn't have a time he's got to rest.
Yeah.
And even when Jesus took time to rest, nobody else could keep up with him. He was working all the time. He's working all the time. Now you want to do as much work as is possible.
Yeah.
And ask God to enable you to do more. See, this is God. God, I'm always working. Jesus, I'm always working. We're talking about working the works of God now. We're not talking about busy. We're not talking about that. We're talking about being active and productive in the kingdom of God. Now, we're not licensed, any of us, to assess other people in this matter. You gotta deal with what your life yourself. We got our hands full with our own life. But everyone does have to assess what's eating up your time. You got to figure it out. I'm figuring out mine.
Mm-hmm.
And even at my age, I still find things, I'm going to have to do a little bit less of that and more of this. You know, it's just assessing. Jesus, he didn't have to make hard decisions that way. He just, his default mode was working with the Father.
Uh-huh.
That was his default mode. And if you follow him, that will become your default mode.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
You want to work with the Father, be involved in what he's doing. Yes.
Being in sync with God is the best time management there is.
That's right, amen.
There's so many trades in the world that time management is huge and critical to how you do in that profession.
Yeah.
You have to manage your time well.
Yeah.
You have to prioritize so that you make the most of your time on the job. But in new life, being in sync with the Lord is that time management.
Yeah.
That becomes your priority, is doing what the Father does.
And I can tell you from personal experience that time management doesn't work. This was, I can remember when this began, the buzzword, manage your time. It doesn't work. And you may make a diligent effort at doing it, but you're going to have to admit this thing's not ending up like I thought, because man was not made to be a manager. He was made to serve God. You understand what I'm saying? All right, who was Jonathan?
Brother
Aaron, I'm sorry.
Yeah, what Jesus is saying here is, if you ask anything according to God's will, that you'll have it. So everything that Jesus asked, an expression of what God was, of the will of God, of what he was doing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So everything that he asked was answered, because he never misjudged.
Amen.
He was never short-sighted.
Amen.
The explanation of Peter and John going up to the temple and healing the man at the gate beautiful. They said, don't think it's any power or piety in us that this man was healed. They perceived what was being done at the time. And so that's true of any believer.
Amen.
That if we see what God's doing, then you can be the one God does it through.
Amen.
Uh-huh. Amen.
I wanted to offer one explanation there, too, why these time management systems don't work. Because you can't plan a crisis. That's the weak link in the thing. You can't plan a crisis. But when you're working for the Lord manages crises.
Yeah. Amen.
It changes. Anyway, yes.
And that's where my mind went too, as you were saying that. I appreciate your clarification. So an example of that would be, I know every day when I go to the hospital, there are certain responsibilities that are expected of me specifically, but then there's the general availability that I have to have.
Mm-hmm.
So unless there are meetings and there are scheduled parts of my day, but at any point a crisis could trump that.
That's right.
Or a greater need could overthrow that. So, but one becomes the priority, and it would be wrong to set aside what is of greater urgency for the thing that was scheduled.
Yeah,
that's right.
Uh-huh. Now you can deal with time in a wise way, so you're always alert, see, to a call from God or to some sort of what may appear to be an interruption, but it's actually an opportunity. You can live so you're aware of those things.
Another thing called would be a
stewardship of time.
Stewardship of time.
Yeah. That's right. You're only given so much, and you're not told how much you're given. Now Jesus said one time, "Verily I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself. He can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do. For what things ever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise." So, in reference to the work that just happened, Jesus saw what the Father was going to do. He entered into it. These people criticized it because they didn't understand that God is free to do whatever he wants to do whenever he wants to do it. And Jesus lived so he was always available. Now, the degree to which you can do this, I don't pretend to know, but I can tell you I want to improve in that area, to always be available. There's some activities, they're not wrong of themselves, right? But they have a distracting factor that sort of blinds you to what other opportunities.
Yeah, a key element in this exchange is the unbelief of those that
That's
were
right.
persecuting
That's right.
him.
Mm-hmm.
His words, if they had believed who he was, would have retrieved them from this
Amen.
Condition.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Now, after he said this, you'd think, well, I'm thinking people can see that. That's perfectly clear. But the Jews sought the more to kill him. See, it incensed them. What he told them was, "My Father, God..." He was their father too, their God too. He's always working. I'm always working. I only do what the Father tells me to do, and what I see the Father doing is what I do. And it made him more zealous to kill him. We're exposed to the aggressive nature of flesh. Now you have to kind of learn this. Some of us, it took a while for us to pick up on it, how aggressive the flesh is. It's very demanding. It's very hostile toward anything that interferes with what it wants to do. This is the nature of flesh. There's been people that their homes have been destroyed because they couldn't check flesh. That's what happened. So we're exposed to the aggressive nature of flesh. They sought the more. So you need... See, the flesh is directed by Satan. That's what he's got to work with when it comes to humanity. Is the flesh. Now, the scripture says of evil men and seducers, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. All right, that's, it said of Manasseh, before his retrieval. So Manasseh made Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to err and to do worse than the heathen. In Jeremiah's day, this is written, yet they hearken not, God said, yet they hearken not unto me, nor incline their ear, but harden their neck. They did worse than their fathers. They did worse. Neither sin nor righteousness is static. Peter said, he wrote of the people that are again entangled therein, entangled in the thing they were delivered from, entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. See, there's two directions a person can go. He can go forward or backward. Upward, downward. He can increase or diminish. Is it? Yes, Brother Isaac.
In Pilgrim's Progress, that pilgrim had went up a hill, and the scroll he was carrying fell from him. Yeah. So he had to go back and go over the ground he had already gone over, and he had to go over it again to get to his where he actually dropped the scroll. So, and what you're, what I feel like what you're saying is like it gets worse and worse. Yeah, you can recover, but it's going to take a very long time for you to do so.
Mm. It takes extraordinary effort.
Yes.
See, of it, without effort, it just continues to go down. So if a person, go ahead.
And we can't presume upon this.
Uh-huh.
The fact that God is merciful, and there are, there's hope there.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to take that away, but it's not a guarantee.
That's right.
You can no more decide to turn around after you've backslidden than you could decide to come to Christ initially.
That's right.
Without his intervention. Hmm. And in that example that Brother Isaac gave of Pilgrim's Progress, it was when he fell asleep.
Yeah.
In other words, an intentional, he didn't, he wasn't walking and, wait a minute, I want to go back there and do, it wasn't that sort of a thing where you willfully just turned again and said, no, I love my sin, I'm going to hold on to it.
Yes, Brother Justin?
Yeah, the Spirit speaks in the book of Revelation of Apollyon opening up what he called a bottomless pit.
Yeah.
Satanic influence is bottomless. There's no depth to it.
Mm-hmm. Now, again, this is very personal, so I'm just going to apply this to myself, that's all. But if you find something in you that is less than it was recently. Some area where you went, you've gone backward, you're less sensitive, whatever. You have to address that immediately.
Yeah, amen.
Yes. This is not going to go away.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
You have to address it. And I know that there are people that they never imagined they'd fall as far as they did, but the reason they did is if you didn't pay attention. First, Satan tries to lull you to sleep so you won't know what's going on, see? But if sometimes you come to a fellowship, you come into an environment where you're hearing about the things of God. And all of a sudden, poof, light shines on somebody. Oh, whoa, I've went backward here. See? Then that's the time to address it. Grace, you're going to address it.
Yes.
See? And it won't grow worse and worse.
Amen.
Yes, Brother?
I was thinking about that. That's what should have happened with these Jews.
Yes,
that's right.
This man doing this on the Sabbath day.
Yeah.
Instead of thinking that he's the transgressor,
uh-huh.
they should have thought, what's wrong with our thinking?
That's right.
Yeah. Amen.
The man that was healed, the blind man in John 9, he said, we know God doesn't hear sinners.
Yes.
He actually destroyed the Pharisees' argument.
That's right.
Amen.
About this. Is we know that God doesn't hear sinners.
Amen.
Yeah, this matter of, I just recently have gone over this with a couple of different people about the sisters speaking, and they weren't able to see that God, if he gives somebody to say something that it's right for them to say, it doesn't make any difference who is, it's right because God gave it to them. But see, this was like, well, that's not in the Bible. Nowhere does it say that in the Bible. See, because their doctrine is, they're locked in, and they just can't receive, even though their doctrine isn't in the Bible. What I mean, there's some things said in the Bible, but it's not their doctrine.
It's not even enough to form
a doctrine. No, it's not. And so, see, they formulated something just like these men have. Yeah. And but when you reason with them and you see something, it's God's blessing us.
Yeah.
And blessing them. Well, that isn't enough. A blessing isn't enough, but see, it should be enough. It really should be, just like this should have been.
Yeah. Yes, Brother Jonathan.
Yeah, I appreciate that note you talked, what you just said there about like detecting that you're lesser in some area. When something's becoming lesser, that's a sign that it's withering, and what withers, it dies.
Yeah.
Any one of us who play instruments can tell you, like the world says, you don't use it, you lose it.
Yeah,
you can
right.
play so masterfully, and then you just put it on the shelf for a week, it'll look like you never knew how to play one to begin with. And so things of God, you can't afford to just put them down. Otherwise, you won't even have it. You'll have to like literally start over if you were to pick it back up again. So that was a special word for me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now you'll find that in this area of sensitivity, you won't hear much said about this in the Christian world. Mm-hmm. You won't hear much said about sensitivity. Mm-hmm. But the longer I live, the more I see how critical this is.
Amen.
Of being sensitive, aware of your condition, examining yourself. It's not a one-time thing, examining yourself to see if you're in the faith. That's not a one-time thing. That's a constant thing. Why? Because you are subjected to eroding influences.
That's right.
See, you're not living in a vacuum.
Uh-huh.
You're living where there's a constant pressure on you all the time. Sometimes you're more aware of it than others, but you want to ask the Lord to help you to be keenly aware of what's going on where you're at.
Uh-huh.
What kind of influences are here? And it'll protect you.
Amen.
Yes.
On this note about being worse and worse, or that point that you were making, that they can keep decreasing, there is another side of that to be seen and to be experienced. You brought it up. We've been changed from glory to glory.
Oh, yeah.
Uh-huh.
You can keep going higher and higher. Doubt sees a mountain, but faith sees a victory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You're...
So in these things where you can go, Brother Justin mentioned a bottomless pit. Well, in growing in the Lord, in His truth, there's no ceiling.
That's right. Yeah.
It's a bottomless pit. But it's also, there's no ceiling to how high you can go.
That's right. Uh-huh. See, that's why I said that no person is static. They are either going up or going down.
That's right.
Coming near or backing away.
That's right.
See, there's no static means you just set in concrete. No one's that way. If Satan can convince you they're that way, he's got you. So when he created this doctrine, once you're saved, you're always saved.
Yeah.
You don't have to worry about anything. See, that was created by the devil.
That's right.
Because it disarms people.
Uh-huh.
Disarms them. Because you're not, you're in a war zone.
Yes. Amen.
You're in a war zone, and it is more fierce than you dare to imagine. How fierce, and we're talking about principalities and powers. We're not talking about little pygmy individuals.
Uh-huh.
We're talking about armies of demons, legions of demons, and Satan, the prince of the power of the air. You're in his domain.
There are a lot of connections to be made in this.
Mm-hmm.
But one that impresses me is the alarm at the realization that you've departed from God some way.
Yes.
And what people would call large or small. But if you ever find yourself doing something or saying something, and all of a sudden, and this is the Spirit of God teaching us, you realize this is not what God does. This is not more than just keeping a commandment.
Yeah.
It's like, I am not being like my father.
Yeah.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
This is alarming.
Amen.
And it's accompanied by a sense of urgency to mm-hmm. get it corrected.
Amen.
Amen.
Now see, you mentioned this once saved, always saved doctrine. If people had that lively awareness of the presence of God with them and the fact that we are created in the image to be in the very image of the Son of God, mm-hmm. that whenever they see, nobody would have to tell them, oh well, once you're saved, you're always saved. That wouldn't be the issue. It would become a non-issue. It's like mm-hmm. being godly would be the issue.
Mm-hmm. We don't question. It's not that people are in and out of the kingdom. Everybody understands this, I'm sure. But we are kept by the power of God through faith.
Yeah. Yes.
And when faith wanes, everything is accessed by faith.
That's right.
Gets further from you.
Yeah. Yep. Amen.
This war zone we're in, it's a battle that gets hotter as it progresses. Because we have that text that says that, you know, if you can't deal with footmen, how can you contend with horses? Every time in combat, they send the weaker ones out first.
Oh, yeah.
Even in medieval combat, they had troops, they called them cannon fodder. That's when their opponents had a lot of artillery, so they'd send these people just to use up all their ammo, and then they'd send their strong troops in. Mm-hmm. So, sometimes people have to say, hey, this is just the cannon fodder. There's much worse.
That's right.
There's much more fierce. Whatever you've overcome, just plan on a stronger foe coming after that one.
Yeah.
Now, these Jews were not only incensed because he broke their perception of the Sabbath, but he said God was his father.
Yeah.
That's what he said. My father works hitherto. So he said that my father. Now, this is the first time those words are uttered by Jesus, as far as we know, in the Gospels. My Father. It's found 29 more times in the Gospels. It's my Father. It's found 29 times more in this Gospel, the Gospel of John, and 47 times in the Gospel. See, this is the point that Jesus accentuates this. God. He's my father. Not in a sense that he's everybody's father. He's the father of us all. Not in that sense. I'm the only begotten of the Father. Now, there wasn't a lot about this now in the prophets. The only prophecy I know of that give us some indication that the Messiah would be like father, connected with father, was Isaiah's prophecy in Isaiah 9:6. His name would be called Everlasting Father. Uh-huh. Right. But the Messiah, so far as I know, was never referred to otherwise as Father. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. So that sounded, the way these people use the scripture, their conclusion sounded right. Uh-huh. But it was dead wrong.
Yeah.
There was enough in the scripture about this, even though it's just a phrase, there's enough in there to know that the Messiah was going to have an intimate association with the Father. And they knew that to say God your Father, Jesus was making himself equal with the Father. Now there are still people in the Christian world that wrestle with whether Jesus is equal with the Father. In the Christian world we're talking about, they wrestle with this. But he by saying my Father, that makes him equal with the Father. See, they knew that made him equal with the Father. Some of the other versions read there, he claimed equality with God, equating himself with God, putting himself on par with God, putting himself on the same level as God, which he was. He received worship from people. There's several instances in scripture where they worshiped him. Someone would come and they'd worship him. If they worshiped anybody else, it had been wrong.
That's right.
So he was equal with the Father. The doctrine of Jesus developed this thought that he was on equality with the Father. And I'll close with some of these. He said, I and my Father are one.
Yeah.
Well, that's quite a statement.
Yeah.
He said, the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment to the Son. Boy, it's telling you, this is what the Father thinks of the Son. And Jesus said that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which has sent him. What about people that don't honor the Son? They don't do what he says. They don't forsake all and follow him. They don't do that. What is that? That's not honoring God. That's what that is, not honoring God. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. See, they say, well, no, I got other priorities. They're not honoring God. See, this is how critical this is. And then he said, he that has seen me has seen the Father. If you want to have a visual representation of the Father, and he's not talking about appearance here, you understand. He has seen me. You see how I talk. You see how I walk. You see what I do. You've seen the Father. This is the kind of things the Father does and says. Uh-huh. And he said, all things that the Father hath are mine. John 16, 15. All things. Boy. Yeah. So you say, what about we? We have all things. Well, no, it's measured to you. It's just measured by your faith.
That's right.
He's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, but it's not the same as with Jesus. Yours is measured by your faith, measures how much of this you get. Well, Jesus had it all.
Amen.
Without measure, he had it all. So by nature, Jesus is not minus any divine quality.
Yes.
That's how you want it. That's what he told them. They couldn't see this, but there was more to this incident than just them. There were the succeeding generations that would hear this. So you want to become keenly aware of this. You cannot talk about God without bringing Jesus into the matter.
Yes.
And your attitude toward God is measured strictly by your attitude toward Jesus. Yeah. And your attitude toward Jesus is measured by your attitude toward his brethren. That's the way it works. Well, it's and if you have something you'd like to add, I think I'll close there. All right, well, it's good to see everybody with good understanding tonight.